This video is being sponsored by Trio.do's Full Stack Developer Program. I found this to be a great place to build real-world industry-grade projects to learn and grow your career with confidence. You will start from basics like HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, and go all the way to React and Node.js to build web apps and deploy them. The best part is you learn by doing. They allow you to add 8 projects to your resume, boost your confidence in your skills, and get a great portfolio on the web that can impress recruiters.
Through their guided modules, you'll be building beautiful responsive websites by writing code on their online workspace. You'll be building all kinds of full-stack web applications, and they also have a Slack community
where you don't feel alone and interact with mentors.
To know more, you can check their page. My audience gets a 40 to 50% discount on using the coupon Rachit.
So, hey everyone, this is me, Rachit, and welcome to yet another video. I am here with Monica Agarwal. She has recently joined Microsoft as a level 62 software engineer. And if you don't know, it's a very big deal. Trust me, I can tell you I'm an ex-Microsoft developer. You can trust me on that. So I'm very much happy to have you over here. And in this particular video, I just want to understand that during these unfortunate situations of COVID, I think that the interview experiences have changed a lot. And I think the audience will really benefit from your overall experience, how it was like. And then we'll also be deeping dive into a few details like how were the design rounds like. And since you were also hired as a level 62 developer, so I would also like to understand how was that different from the general interviews which we give for SG1s or SG2 level positions. So with that, I welcome Monica to this YouTube channel. And would you like to give a more thorough introduction about yourself?
Hey, hi, Rachit. So thanks for this introduction. And it's like a dream come true moment because I've been watching your videos almost all throughout the last years. And I've learned a lot from your videos. So with 7+5 years of experience and a lot of time during COVID, I just thought of giving the Microsoft and a lot more interviews. And I happened to crack Microsoft. I'm here to share my experience because I have always looked forward to others sharing their experiences and I've learned a lot from them. So I hope me sharing will help a lot of people out there. Yeah.
And I also had a brief chat with Monica before this quite a few times. And I really love that your intent is to share information so that you can at least help few people out there. And I'm sure that you are going to help a lot of people with this video. So with that, I would like to begin this session. So are you ready?
Yeah, sure, Rachit. Little nervous, but I'm ready.
Yeah. So the first question that I want to start with is like, what was your interview process like? I am sure that with COVID, there were a few changes which might have happened. And since you already have 7 years of experience, so I think you can really, you know, tell us about how interviews were before COVID and how they have changed during COVID. Especially when you're talking about Microsoft.
Yeah. So this is the first time actually I got a call from Microsoft. I have never applied from Microsoft before. And the good thing about COVID is a lot of hiring is happening across all the companies. So I was literally spammed with interview calls. And I decided to give interviews because I was like, so I'm getting so many calls. I should at least give it a try. I was very happy with my current job. So the one big change which has happened with COVID is you will get a lot of interview calls. And I was in a product company, maybe that is why. If you're not in a product company, I would highly recommend joining Naukri.com. It has helped me a lot in the past in getting the interview calls. And from the process point of view with Microsoft, I got a call from Microsoft on a particular day that would you be interested? And then they scheduled my interview on a particular date. And it was a very like, now you have this, now you have that. I did not have much of a recruiter interaction, which I had with other companies. So this was different for Microsoft. Yeah.
I see. And like right now you are saying that you were getting a lot of calls. So you right now were working in Make My Trip before this, I think.
Right.
And then you were getting all these calls, but you were not registered on multiple websites. So was it through LinkedIn?
Yes, through LinkedIn. So all the recruiters were messaging through LinkedIn. I actually flunked the first interview, which was Amazon. I just flunked the first interview like very badly. And I was feeling very bad about myself. And I was like, up to crack karna hi hai. And the next 1.5 months, I gave my 100%. Yeah.
I see. And before this, like you ever dreamt of like working at Microsoft, but like you told you never applied. So what was the reason?
I have always like wanted to become a good software engineer. And because I'm not from a CSE background, I never thought in terms of FAANG, Google, Microsoft or anything. I always thought of becoming a good software engineer. the fact that you become a good software engineer by being in that company, that was my motivation. So I was not very fond of, you know, working in big tech companies. But for, you know, I started improving, and I saw that if I prepare for these companies, I'm becoming a better software engineer. So let me apply, let me become a better software engineer. And if I crack it, I will join those companies. So that was my approach, basically.
I think it's a very healthy approach, first of all. Like, I understand that it's quite easy, especially when you are really young and you are in your college and you are seeing all people moving in some really, like your friends, they're going in good companies. You kind of, you know, have that longing that I also want to be there someday. But having this approach is really healthy, in which you are only caring about your skills and growing that and becoming a really good software developer, because that's ultimately very, like, it's a very respectable way later on in your life to really enter these companies and rock your team as a software developer.
Exactly. I think it's a 80-20 rule. So 80% you should focus on your skills, but 20% having these as goals helps you. Like, if you did not have that goal, you know, of cracking Google and Microsoft or such companies, you don't know what it takes to be there, right? So that is also there. I would not say that you should not aim for these companies, but you should not die for these companies. You know, you never know. You might not like working there.
Exactly. Yeah, I also take it that way only. Like, always focus on your skills, because that will give you sense of satisfaction as well as respect in your life. And of course, when you're talking about huge tech brands, since the product is their core, the technology is their core, which is helping them drive like billions of revenue annually. So like, it's not very easy to do that. So having this experience of working at such huge brands, and since your profession is a software developer, so it's something that you should really try at least once, and then probably move on if you want to.
Exactly. Yeah. I totally agree. Yeah.
Awesome. So in this case, you got a call, and was there like direct interview scheduled, or were they interested in your resume or some call with some HR? Like in Google, how this works is you first get a call from Google HR, and they test whether you are able to pass some basic questions like how does hashing work, what is the worst time case complexity. So what was it like in your case?
No, for Microsoft specifically, by the time I got the call for Microsoft, I was actually very prepared. So I was already 1.5 months into my preparation for interviews. I was interviewing for other companies as well. And Microsoft was like a cherry on the top. Yeah, but the interview process, the recruiter just said me that, you know, you have your interview. Would you be interested? I think they already, and I did send them my resume. So, but they didn't ask me any questions. There was not much interaction between me and the recruiter.
I see. So what happened on your, like, was the entire interview happening only on single date, or was it
spanned? That was the best part actually about Microsoft interview, that, you know, there was not much suspense. It started in the morning 9:30 and it went on till evening 6:37. So one after the other, if you clear the interviews, they'll tell you, they'll give you a half an hour break and they'll tell you you've cleared, and they'll schedule your other interview. So I really like that approach.
Was it different than the interview experiences you had with Amazon or some other company?
Yeah, so most of the other companies, except Adobe, I would say, even Adobe had the same approach of scheduling all the interviews on a single day. Most of the companies were like, they schedule. So see, different things work for different companies. I won't say that stick to one, but having one interview after the other, just there was no suspense. But otherwise, most of the companies were like, first they'll schedule an interview, then they'll take time, they'll give a feedback, then they'll schedule another interview. So interview chal raha hota hai 2 weeks, 3 weeks tak. So pata hi nahi hota hai, hoga, nahi hoga, how did you do? So a lot of suspense, yeah.
Right. So how many rounds you had total in Microsoft?
Four rounds.
All right. So can you just give a brief summary of each round?
Yeah. So first round, the first question was around some, so I won't disclose the exact question, but it was a hard problem solving question, right? And it was related to a graph algorithm, but union find algorithm, but I had not studied union find algorithm by that point of time. So later on I came to know that achha ye to union find algorithm hai, but what helped me was cracking the coding interview, that approach with which Gail has told, that you know, ABCD, all the alphabets you have, so you take an array of 26 alphabets. So that approach I took, and I was able to solve the question. So I would highly recommend reading that book to everybody. And then they asked me about my most challenging project in round one, and they went a little deep into that. That was it about the first round. Second round was, again, they were asking me about my current role at Make My Trip, and that led to caching and some system design. Then they deep dived into how caching works. Then they asked me a question about caching, problem solving question, and then they asked me about my current project.
Okay.
Round three was system design, but the system design was asked in my current role, right? So they were asking me system design, not like usual system design questions which I have found in other companies. So they ask you a Twitter system design or something like that. But in this case, they asked me about my favorite project, and then they see if I know the system in and out here at Make My Trip, right? Then the fourth round was more of, you know, testing my imagination skills, how much I can, you know, imagine. My 3D imagination skills mostly. And they also asked me two problem solving questions. And because I told them that I know Java and Golang both, so they asked me to write a code in both, and they wanted to test my proficiency in both the languages.
All right. So when you have mentioned that, I think a lot of people who already have few years of experience with Golang or Java, probably they do not apply to Microsoft a lot, because they also have this inertia or this thinking or hesitation that, since Microsoft is C# and Azure heavy based, they probably won't, like, you know, have a good fit with them. But I think your experience totally proved that wrong. Like, I have also said this in many videos, like, the language does not matter. Language is like, English is a language, and it's allowing you to communicate your thoughts. Similarly, any language is allowing you to have your software do some stuff. It can be any language.
Yeah. And the fact that you are a good software developer means that you're not tied to a single language, right? So language is just a tool. If you are sticking to a single language, how will you be able to adapt to some other language, which might become the thing in the next year, like next year or two?
Yeah. Right. But I do have a bit conflicting view on that, because I think as you gain experience, obviously you should have the flexibility to adapt to other languages. But I think as you spend time, you also kind of develop some tendency about, like, you really like this language and you want to deep dive further. So, like, how do you develop? Every organization loves to have subject matter expertise on every language they work with. So those persons are those that chose not to switch their languages and always pick such opportunities, which allow them to, you know, face even more challenging problems associated with that language.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, I don't think that way. So, yeah, it depends. Like, if you want to deep dive into a particular language, you can. At least one language you should know very well.
Like, exactly. That's
that helps you in understanding how the computer works, how the language works. So, at least one language, I would say, yes. But, yeah.
Yeah.
We can have different views on that.
Awesome. So, So I think your interview session was like a mix of both problem solving as well as design rounds. Although I feel it was quite a bit heavy on the design part. And since your level was also not for a junior position, that makes sense. Right?
Yeah. But then also I would say like data structure and problem solving helped me a lot. In the sense that problem solving, when I was writing the code, I had practiced a lot on the editor. So I had not done that in the past. This is the first time when I was preparing, I was practicing a lot on the editor, and it helped me, you know, in approaching problem solving questions, because writing code was never an issue for me. I was very quick in writing. So it was only the thought process and the thinking. Previously, what used to happen, writing also would, like, either on paper or on, it used to consume my energy. But here, because it was not consuming my energy, the interview was almost amazed at the way I was, you know, writing code, like, fatafat. So I would highly encourage people to practice problem solving on editor. Yeah.
Yeah. You are saying something like lead code, where you have problem, you write code, you submit, and you see whether it's getting accepted or not.
No, I'm saying just open a notepad or a Google Doc
Okay.
and practice there. Like Google Doc also, you can do some settings so that it looks like code.
Yeah.
You can find it on the internet.
Like the
But
auto
yeah,
like the auto capital
yes.
first line, it's really irritating.
That is very irritating. So you can do some settings change
Yeah.
over there and you can practice. Lead code will not give you that feel which a simple notepad or an editor will give you.
I
So
see.
I would say just an editor, yeah.
But what about Microsoft rounds? Like, were they asking you to write code similar to Google on a Google Doc plain text editor where you do not have any tools
Yes,
for
yes.
computing?
Yes, they had a they had a code link where you had to write code. Like it was a plain text.
Okay.
It and none of them gave, like lead code like things you can run and see whether you
Right,
cannot compile your code there, right?
right.
Or you cannot run your code there. So that helped me actually, yeah. So they did make me write the solution.
Right. Right. And that's one of the tips which I had also mentioned in my videos of 5 tips of using lead code effectively. So the problem with lead code and real world interviews is that in lead code, you are sitting here writing some garbage code and hitting compile. It's breaking, you fix that. You hit again, run, and it's failing. You fix that, and you get accepted, and you feel like, yes, today I have solved 10 problems. I am like really, working on myself and improving. But in real interviews, you do not even know whether it's going to compile or are there any compilation errors. Also, you don't know whether it's going to break or not. So, I really suggest a lot and focus on this a lot that even if you're using lead code for your preparation at that point of time, it's always good to. Before, like, use that submit button like you would really treat with interviewers. That submit button over there is same as saying that yes, I am confident with my code, and you can now check it.
Yes. And one more tip which you have given in your interviews, which I used, is that when you solve a lead code problem, suppose you were able to solve it in two or three iterations, right? At least go back a week later and solve that question again and not on lead code. Solve it on your IDE, right?
Yeah.
Like, or on your notepad, then run it. See if you got it in one go. Don't write, I mean, just upsolve your questions. That is what I would say. Like,
Exactly.
yeah.
Because it's not about whether you are able to solve it in a day or two. Of course, after struggling a lot, you can. But the real thing which will impress someone is your ability to not let luck play a role on that day and you're still doing a good job, which needs you to have this quality of, writing bugless code and having that confidence where you can scan any code and talk where is the bug or is it like really going to work or not, which needs you to do those things which you have mentioned.
Totally, yeah, I totally agree.
Awesome. Moving on to the other things, what were your algorithm rounds like? Were there some hard questions? How would you categorize the overall experience for the algorithm or problem-solving rounds?
So medium to hard questions, I would say. On three of the rounds, I got problem-solving questions, right? On third round, it was completely system design. They were hard questions, medium to hard questions. But if your concepts are very clear, like if you have solved the same problem yourself at least twice or thrice, so I believe in solving the same question twice or thrice rather than solving three different questions, right? Like, in the sense that it should really embed in your brain that what is really going on, and then you can apply it in 10 other questions. So practice medium to hard questions, I would say. Easy questions are not going to help you, but practice it in a way that you are able to completely solve it on your own.
Yeah, that's really very much. And these things, they are very small, but they really matter a lot. And I know for sure a lot of people overlook these things. Like they really focus on how many problems are they solving. And problem solving is fun if if you really enjoy it.
You will be ashamed if I really tell you how many questions. I would be ashamed to tell that how many questions I've solved on lead code. Like, I've not solved many questions on lead
Yeah, but
code.
that doesn't
But
matter.
I,
Exactly the point. Like
yeah.
moving on to the other things about system design, I think I want to know myself as well. What were the rounds like? Because I think this was all happening on remote call, right? And when you are like pre-COVID interviews, you have whiteboard. You still, you can add that you are thinking something and you can scribble anything. So all those things are gone. Like, did you buy any pen tablet or something? Like, how was the design round happening? Because I'm really curious to know.
So they gave a link, a design link where you can draw shapes and everything. So that was there. So that was a sharing doc which we were using, like not only in Microsoft, in other companies also.
Nice.
So it you will feel like the same. So for me, the experience has not been very different than in-person interviews, actually. It's very convenient because you are at home. You don't have to travel a lot. Like, it takes 15 minutes for you to get ready for the interview, and it saves a lot of energy. And you have, so companies have taken care of key design round hoga, so they will share a design link, a code link. So it is, the experience has been very smooth. Yeah,
I see. So, but you did not have any pen tablet, so that is not necessary, right?
No, so as a rule, I always kept a pen and a paper with me, right? Because in case of emergency, you might need that, the link is not working or something like that. Or just to, you know, note down your thoughts. But I never happened to use it to, you know, show it to the interviewer or something, because we had proper links shared.
Okay. So like you were all drawing the components and architecture using some like tools, like shape.
Yes, it felt a little weird because you're not used to it. You're drawing, you're not good at drawing. So you draw weird shapes. You're not drawing the correct shape for what means a database and everything. But the interviewer also understands that. And in most of the cases, interviews are very friendly, right? They want you to succeed. So they understand that, you know, what they just focus on what you're trying to explain them. So I got a question from one person on LinkedIn that, you know, I stammer a lot. And they always say that we need good communication skills. So stammering is not a problem, because stammering doesn't mean you are not good at communication, right? Communication means you're able to clearly share your thoughts. The same thing with design docs and code links. Yeah.
I see. That's great. I think there are two ways to tackle this better. Probably, like, it's good that Microsoft and the company and other companies are also understanding that we are working in a limited capacity of, you know, working remotely and doing this. So yeah, it's good they understand. But I think you can probably, as a candidate, do more of practice. Like, you are practicing code on Google Docs, so probably you can also practice few system design architecture drawing yourself on some tool, and so that you also happen to, you know, catch on that really real quick when it's your real interview.
I agree. I did not personally do that, but now looking back, I think I could have. So that, yeah, I think that is a good tip to have. If you have, like, if you are that much engrossed in preparing for the interviews, right? Like, most of the people don't give so much time. Yeah.
Plus, you are having a job, and then COVID is happening. You are staying with family, I think. So you already have a lot of going on your plate.
No, so family, though, I did not talk for like 3 months. That time I had a deal with them that, you know, for these 3 months, just leave me alone, because I had a lot of work in office. I was doing a very interesting project in office also. So yes, you have to manage your time. This is something you want to do, right? So you have to do some sacrifice. Yeah.
Right. Regarding system design interviews, although I feel that a lot of developers, especially who have around 2 years of experience, they are really, you know, tensed about such interviews. And I do understand, because I have been there. I have been in that position. Like, when I was also at Microsoft and I was about to leave, and I was also giving interviews. So I had been at that situation where I was really troubled that whether I'll be doing good or not. For data structures or problem solving, I was really confident, because I have been practicing that for years. But design, I think that really, you know, you can expect someone to be really good at it who has actually 3 or 4 years of experience building things. And when I joined Microsoft as a fresher, I was actually not given a lot of responsibilities that allowed me to understand or grasp that knowledge, which allows me to portray how good I am with designs. Because frankly speaking, I did not do that a lot. What do you think? Like, what is your tip on such developers who are in that position?
So when you are 2 years experience, right? Like, system design is my favorite topic. For me, system design has been much easier than actually data structure and algorithms. So for 2 years of experience, I think what Gaurav has on his playlist, right? And there is Tushar, Narendra, there is one more person. I don't remember his name now. So I think YouTube has enough content for a 2 year experience person to understand system design. And system design is something like, think of it like if you were to design something, right? Like, how would you do it? Like, and you can do it. Like, it's nothing. It's like, if you can do it, right? First of all, have faith in yourself, right? And give interviews, right? See where you're going wrong, where you're going right, right? So for me, like, I used to always get stuck in system design questions where they ask routing based questions, right? So go back, practice it. But I think what is there, have belief that you are a 2-year experienced person. You will not be expected. So take advantage of that, right? Tumse zyada expect karenge hi nahi. So, and just give your best. Like the playlist on YouTube, I think is enough for system design. Yeah.
I see. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's a good starter to, you know, get acquainted with what is the kind of, like, what is the kind of questions and what are the kind of communications involved when you have to answer such questions. But I feel also have, I think I do have few tips that I want to mention over here. I think that when you are in college, I know few superstars who have been doing so great. And the best thing for handling system design for me is to, you know, get started building a project or web app and deploying it to some real server that will allow you to, so do a full stack kind of project. And I think it's too mainstream, but it's not.
Yeah.
Like if you do it the right way, you will have us. Like I know 2 years of experienced software developers who do not know a lot about how really internet works and how really the production app is working and what it takes to take your code and let your users enjoy it. So a lot of people do not have that oversight. But if you kind of do projects which allow people to like take off a simple note-taking application, if you build something with SOAuth 2, like log in with Google and I'm able to take my notes and you save that when I log in, I can check that. So this involves front end, back end, OAuth 2. Then you will also need a web server. So probably you will study Nginx or something, right? So having such kind of things, and then probably you can also add alerting on top of it. Like if something is breaking, your API is not working, you get Slack alerts. So doing even a tiniest, smallest project yourself is going to, you know, like you can do this in college time also. As you are saying, there is a lot of free content on YouTube. So just doing it yourself would allow you to really pick up well in system design rounds, because at end, it's all about connecting front end with the database, with the back end in between.
Yes. So I would tell you one thing. So I am 7.5 year experienced person, right? So all the learning which I have done is on the job, right? If what I have learned on the job, you're doing it on your own, you will be able to achieve it even faster, right? Like, the fact that I did not clear, I have given Amazon interviews 1.5 year after 1.5 year experience, and I was not able to clear the interviews. Why was I? Because I did not have enough experience, and also I did not do what you were saying, right? Like we should have done. That's a personal choice. I did not have time for that. Like, but if you are really passionate about it, you should do it. I have learned everything on the job, but if it depends upon what your personal goals are. If you're 2 year experience and if you want to crack system design interviews, the tip that you've given, it will just level you up to another level, right? Yeah. So I would highly encourage you doing it, because for me, it used to like constantly bug ki mujhe nahi pata what is happening, how is the front end getting connected to back end. It used to keep bugging me. It's just that I did not do anything like that, which you told, and I never learned it until unless I got a project like that in my job, right? Right. So I would highly second that. Yeah.
Yeah, because that's exactly what I felt like. I had been working in a really huge tech brand where the scope of my responsibility was really less. That allowed me to write good code, good quality code, good solid design principles, but it was not giving me visibility enough to really do a good job in system design interviews. So that's one of the reasons I feel that if you can work in a startup, because startups, they don't have the flexibility. Exactly. So you will actually know what it takes to deploy an app in production, how to roll back, how is Git versioning so important at that point of time. So all those things. So that's the best experience. And I really love my current firm for that as well. Like I have been learning a lot and all these things. I feel that doing that allows you to really do a good job in system design rounds as well.
Yes, I totally agree to that. Yeah.
Awesome. Thanks. So after your interview rounds, like you said 4 rounds, was there any manager round or HR round also after that?
No. So the fourth, so all the rounds were taken by very senior person. So I liked that about Microsoft actually. Because from the very start, I was looking forward to learn something from them. So they did not ask me pointed managerial questions, but they did ask me like, why are you looking for a change? Right. I had my answer ready. Like why not Microsoft? Like, and yeah, what are the challenges? And I think not very specific managerial questions in Microsoft. Yeah.
I see. And were you also giving some, so you mentioned that there were a few questions like, what was the challenging situation, what was the challenging product you worked on. So did you also use something like STAR methodology while you were answering to that, or you just be being honest and just whatever came in your mind, or you
So honesty will not work in interviews, frankly speaking. Like, don't be too honest. So you have to take it like you are selling yourself. So the STAR method will be a good approach. I really understand, like, preparing for it is little like you are not able to prepare that way. So try PRAMP or something like that. Try giving mock interviews. Mm-hmm. And try giving interviews where you really don't care ki hoga to theek hai, nahi hoga to theek hai. That are also your practice interviews. So, and use use the STAR method or any method where you are able to sell your skills, right? Like, right. Interview is all about selling your skills, right? So don't be too honest in the interviews is my take, and prepare your answers before. Like, what was your contribution? Right. How did you uplift the team, right? What was the impact? What was the outcome and the result, right? So I did use that method.
I think we can also put it up as like, just be professional about answering such questions. I think that's a more positive way.
Yeah, I mean, people, yes. If I say don't be honest, people will be like, okay, jhoot bolna hai kya? Nahin, I'm not saying jhoot bolo, but... don't be too vulnerable in the interview.
Just be a bit prepared of answering that, because you want to they are also expecting a bit professional answer that allows them to understand what was the situation, because they have been through that experience. They don't know.
Exactly. And everybody, you know, so everybody has their flaws and strengths, right? So you don't have to constantly show your flaws, right? Like, you have to show your strengths because you will be already working on your flaws. Right. So interviews is not a platform to open up on your flaws, right? It is a platform to show them that you have strengths and skills which will help the company grow.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that definitely needs some time to prepare. And I feel giving multiple interviews also, like, one is having that content prepared, the other is delivery. Mm-hmm. So I feel giving multiple interviews where you are kind of asked such questions again and again also helps you sell yourself in a very appropriate way that really impresses them.
Right. Yeah.
All right. Awesome. So I think the overall intent is these are uncomfortable tips, first of all, because, you know, instead of solving three problems, you are solving one problem three times with time. Mm-hmm. It's really uncomfortable. Not a lot of people will be doing that. Other thing that you're saying is do some preparation on something like PRAMP, or prepare such contents like, what was the most challenging project that you have worked on and why was it challenging? So answering them with STAR methodology and then, you know, rehearsing it, how you are going to deliver it. So all these things, they really take time. And what is the mindset I feel is that they feel like, instead of doing all this, which is so uncomfortable because they have not done it ever, they feel like, let's do more than lead code questions. Probably that will help us. And that's how they are, you know, wasting their time eventually.
I don't know, but for me, what happened is I have written a post also. Like, I was very comfortable with data structure and algorithms 1.5 years into my preparation when I first joined the industry, right?
Right.
The only backlog I got was my development experience. So it is very important for you to respect your current job is what I would say. Like, be it you're liking it or not liking it, you will be learning something in your current job, right? So respect your current job. Just because you want to go into a big tech companies, and I have seen some freshers in my company or in my previous company where they are too obsessed with cracking fang, and they're not giving their 100% in the current company. So I would say you will be working with better people doing almost the same kind of job, maybe in a better way, but why are you leaving out on your experience in the current company? So be honest with your current company, learn a lot and prepare for the better.
Yeah. And I totally agree to that. I have actually faced that myself when I was at Microsoft, which kind of looks like a company to a lot of developers. There were still people who were coming and they were not happy with the pay, and they felt that they probably should go here and there. And they were only crying about things. And what is the thing that they are not realizing is that they actually are giving up on opportunities that you are in this company, you are given some assignments, you are given some job to do. If you can focus on the positives and take the best out of it, it's actually helping you in the best way possible. just crying about things and you're not having that, you're not having this, and generating that negativity is sensed by everyone in the team. So you're losing respect,
Right.
you're being judged, plus it's not helping you. It's not going to, like, if you're crying, it's
so
not.
I did that mistake in my first company, I would be very frank. But things only started changing when I was like, you know what, they are giving me money. So right. I need to give them time. Like, how much ever money they're giving me, I need to give them time, be honest with my work and learn as much as I can. And then, follow, you know, right. do whatever else I want in my life. Yeah.
That's very healthy approach. And that's exactly how I think we started this video also. Like, focus on your skills. They will eventually make you, like, you will also respect your life if you have good skills. Because you will be respected that way.
Yeah.
Awesome. So, after this, like, your interview experiences went, like, real quick. You were already happy. But what, like, were you really expecting that, yeah, you have cracked it? And what about the senior position? Like, were you expecting that you will get such role? So, what was it like?
Yes. So, I was expecting. So, I believe that you should, like, expect a little more always, right? You should not play down yourself too much. So, I had my expectation of L63 level. But I was quite happy even when I got L62. And I was already bummed up that I'm going to work hard, learn a lot, and let's see what happens. So, right. I think level is not that much of a matter.
Right.
Again, the same thing applies, right? Like, you should be already prepared for the next level before you go to the next level. Otherwise, you will be let down by the expectations of others.
That's very wonderfully put. And it's true. Again, it all comes down to working on your skills enough so that if you really deserve that, you will get that.
Right. Yeah.
Awesome. So, but like when you got the offer letter, there are like, you know, this is like the really interesting part about negotiations. Like you got something and then you are like, probably I can get a bit more. So how do you like, how do you make this work? And you have 7.5 years of experience and you have also made a lot of job switches. So I really want you to help us out here.
Yeah. So, negotiation is my second favorite topic after system design, right? So I started very small, I would say, as an electronics and communication engineer, it is not very easy to switch into computer science. I would say for, you have to be better at negotiation, right? You're giving time. If they are giving you money to work, you're also giving your time, right? And you should be paid well. So don't downplay yourself. Like I see a lot of engineers who are like, who don't negotiate and they settle for the less. I've seen a lot of engineers do that. So don't settle for less. Research a lot, right? You are creating a lot of value in the industry. You should be paid for that. So I, and set a minimum bar for yourself, right? Like I would not join any company if I don't get this. Also, I used to set a bar, like I would not join this company if I don't get this, because what are they expecting? Try to understand, you know, try to understand your role in the organization. Are they going to make you work hard a lot? Like, are they expecting a lot of expectations? You would be exciting because the role is challenging, but have a minimum bar in your mind and just ask, right? I would say just ask. And trust me, I have done this twice and I have got what I want, sometimes even more. So just ask, I would say. Yeah.
Yeah, but they tell me no. How do I beat that? They're like, yeah, you want that. Like, how do you beat that? Like, you are saying that, you know, here's the situation. This is what you have offered. But I feel...
So, I will be very honest, right? Don't share your current salary right away.
Okay.
Don't share your current salary right away. You're not liable to tell your current salary to anybody, right? But they might, like, it might help them in deciding, you know, what you want. So, before sharing your current salary, I would say research. Research on how much you can get, right? Talk to people. Most of the people will not share their salaries, and I totally understand that. But some people who are close to you, right, might share some numbers. LeetCode is also a very good platform to know, you know, LeetCode is there, Blind is there.
Glassdoor.
So just Glassdoor is not a good platform, I would say, because I think the numbers are not real. They are very low. Software engineers are getting even more than what is there on Glassdoor. So research a lot, set a number in your mind, right? And set a minimum number in your mind, right? Ask for little more than the minimum, because they will downplay you and you will not be able to say no to that, right? And yeah, but see, with Microsoft, I was not able to negotiate because they offered me a good enough package, which I cannot negotiate. But I already had an offer which was meeting my expectations, right? Yeah. And at some point of time, you have to be satisfied also. Like after I got my offer, then people were like, I'm getting this, I'm getting that. I'm hearing even more crazier numbers, and I for a moment I was like, yaar maine kam pe settle kar liya kya. So then then it comes the other side, right? Like you have to see your own progress, right? So your happiness, you can't like keep right, running right. behind numbers.
Exactly.
So that is also there. Yeah,
exactly. Of course, like after one point, especially when you have met a certain criteria that this was your dream, like essentially when you start as a software developer out of college, you have some dream, and after 3-4 years you have definitely like you are earning much more than what you have ever dreamt of. So you are kind of, you know, you kind of understand that money is not something which will let you run this profession for 30 years. So you kind of understand the importance of other things in life and not just like blindly run towards the number. So I understand that. But I think the overall tip that you are trying to say is having a competing offer definitely helps. Also do research, like you got to understand about that job level, what is the salary which they might be offering to other people. So do your research over there. Probably try really hard not to disclose your current salary. And one thing is, you should not feel ashamed that they will, you know, back out if you're not disclosing your salary, because this is kind of I had, like, if I, like, it's a standard process. It's not standard. We have made it standard. It's not happening in US, for example.
So, no, but you know why that is not happening? Because we are not confident. Like, you have to be confident now. If you get an offer from, say, I'll take the example of Google, right? If you get an offer from Google and you had imagined that Google pays this much, and then Google is not paying you that much, right? It is just giving you what any other company is giving, right? So it has not met your criteria. So just to show others that you're working in Google, what's the point in accepting that salary when it is not really your dream job? You realize that it's not your dream job. So that is what I would say, is that have a minimum bar in your mind, and don't, like, obviously it should be realistic. So you have to research, and don't compromise then. Ki are Google ka offer aa gaya to kam mein accept kar lenge, aisa nahi hai.
Right. And I think all this can only happen if you are personally satisfied and happy with your skills. Only then you can play this strong card of, you know, I want these things. And that's the one thing that I always focus, like really focus on your skills, so that later on in your life, you have this power that, you know, I want this. I want to live my life like that. If you are able to make me happy, only then I will join. Not to make other happy that I am working here or there, but this, it gives it gives you the freedom to live your life the right way and make decisions that you could have never ever made otherwise.
Yeah. So I totally agree to this strong card part. So negotiation is almost like, who is having the stronger card, right? Like, there will be companies, startups, which are like, ki ispe to they are going to make me work so hard, so I'm going to charge them that, and if not, I will not go. But if a big tech company comes, then your heart softens, ki are, I'm going to get this opportunity. So then they have the strong card. So more and more you're working on your skills, your strong card is heavier for the recruiter.
Exactly, because
and recruiter really like when you actually negotiate. They come to know that, you know, you are in demand.
Exactly.
You will be the nice person to have in your company. They'll run after you, you know, I'm not saying, you know, just play with them because they'll run after you or something like that, but they will finally realize that you are a strong candidate.
Yeah. Right. Right. And yeah. Like, you are not just, you know, a pushover, like, you don't just accept things, you know, and you demand and you raise your voice for what's right. So yeah.
Right.
I think that they will. And they will actually give you more because they are impressed, right? They
right.
want to have you.
Yeah. And they also want to help you. Like, don't treat them as your, matlab,
exactly.
They're not, yeah. If you treat them as your friend, they will be your friend. They want to hire you. You know, it's not difficult. It's very difficult to, you know, get a candidate, interview them, and then crack the interview and then make them accept an offer. And then they finally join. So for them also, it's a very long process. Yeah.
Awesome. Got it. So yeah, thanks a lot for this whole interview session. At end, I just want, if you have any ending message to the audience, that would be great.
I would say just enjoy the process and believe in yourself. Yeah, keep be consistent, believe in yourself, and live your life. I would say just yeah, don't run too much behind these companies.
Yeah, I think that's really important, because when if you talk about people who have not met their dreams, they are actually running towards their dreams. But once you achieve that, you might still not be feeling really happy. So you need to do some other stuff that keeps you happy, and you can do it irrelevant of whether you have met your dream or not. So
yes,
kind of maintain that positivity and still fight for your dreams.
Because you will always be running behind something, right? Like exactly. Always you will be running. If you are not running behind something, you're not living a life. So enjoy the process of running. Yeah,
exactly. That's very beautifully put. I really hope that this whole interview session was very motivating, and you know, it brings a smile across the viewers, and I hope this also helps. And if people have like few more questions, they can ask in comments. And I would request, if you want to like share some social media contacts, if you want people who can, who still have any more questions, to reach out to you.
Yeah, I mean, you can share my LinkedIn profile link.
Awesome.
So that would help. I would like to, I would reply to most of the messages if I get, like, I would try to reply to the messages. Yeah. I don't know if I can reply all of them. But I think, you know, there's enough content, just start working.
Great. Awesome. Thanks again, Monica, for and congratulations for your new role. I hope Microsoft turns out really fruitful and enjoyable, memorable experience for you. And thanks again for all the time for investing. And
yeah, thanks, Rachit, for having me. And I just loved to share my experience. I really hope there's a Monica sitting out there, which, and this will help the other Monica who's sitting on the other side. Yeah.
Yeah, again, I really appreciate your overall intent behind helping people. I actually also love that a lot. It really gives a lot of satisfaction when you can actually see, like, you have helped someone. So, yeah.
Yeah.
It really, really means a lot. So, I really want the audience also to show real love for this video. Smash this like button, subscribe to this channel. And again, reach out to Monica on LinkedIn if you want to still reach out to her anyways. All right? Thanks.